Too many times we pray by rote, not based on understanding of the word of God. So verse 6 of James chapter 1 is critical. Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. I want to believe that it is expected of us that we would know that what we are praying for is in accordance with the will of God. Because that's the only way you are not going to waver. But the minute you are, I didn't know if this is the will of God or not, your praying is useless. So what should we be doing when we're praying? The first thing is to find out what is the will of God. How do you find out the will of God? Study the word of God. Ask him also. It's still part of prayer. But you have to ask. And it must be in faith. We're coming somewhere. We're going somewhere with that. Verse 7. For let not that man, that's the man who is tossed to and fro by the way of the sea, let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Let not who now? What man are we talking about here? The man who is wavering. The man who is not resolute in his asking. The Bible says that man should not think that he's going to get anything from God. Why? Because he's wavering. In fact, the one translation here says, instead of wavering, it says, never doubting. But let him ask with confidence, never doubting. Doubting nothing. Without a doubt. So the moment a man begins to doubt whether what he's asking is in line with God's will or not, what has happened? Verse 7 kicks in. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. So there are things that we must settle before we start saying, I want to ask God for this. This thing that I'm asking, is it according to the will of God? How do I know the will of God? It's in the scriptures. How can I really tell if something is the will of God? Let somebody read for us Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2.
Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Okay, so let's look at what is happening here. The first thing about this man is that, number one, he should what?
Present.
He should present himself as what? A living sacrifice. In those days, when you take the sacrifice, the sacrifice can actually be the animal itself that you want to kill, or the animal after it has been killed, or what you do to get what God has for you. That's the sacrifice. So, when you present that sacrifice, either living or dead, it must be clean. You don't bring an animal that has question marks. The leg is lame, it has a blind spot, it's specked. It must be pure white. So he said we should present ourselves like that sacrifice, but alive. That's number one. The living sacrifice, what else?
Holy.
So what is doing basically is exactly, because for that sacrifice, number one, sacrifice must be accepted. For it to be acceptable, then there must be purity, which is holiness. There was purity, it must have no blemish, which is the acceptability. It must be acceptable. So the man who is coming to God in prayer must be holy, must be acceptable. Now does that preclude a sinner from praying? No. Because there's a sincerity in the heart of the sinner that God sees. God will accept that. because there's sincerity in his heart. But a man who has sin in him and is pretending like he doesn't have sin and is coming before God, it's not a living sacrifice. Do you understand that? Because sacrifice must be acceptable unto God, otherwise God will not even hear that man who's presenting him. What's the next thing it says?
Which is your reasonable service?
It says that by itself is a reasonable act of worship. Your service before God. And then that comes to verse 2, where he says, and be ye not conformed. Is that not true?
Yes.
But be ye transformed. We've discussed this several times. The way you are going to know the will of God from the scriptures is, number one, you have presented yourself unto God as a living sacrifice. You know that living sacrifice, you can do anything with sacrifice. You can tie it to the horn of the altar without killing it. You can slaughter it, draw its blood. When it has been killed, you put it on top of the, what's it called now? The fire, and it is consumed. Sometimes it is the whole burnt offering is consumed. Whatever that sacrifice is to be used for, it is used for that purpose. So a person who is going to God in a place of prayer must have totally surrendered himself. These are some of the nitty-gritty things about praying. Not only that, it now tells us not to be conformed, but to be transformed. We cannot be following the fashion or the lifestyle of the people of this world. Be designing our lives according to how they live their own lives, according to how they see things, and expect that we are going to know the will of God. The moment you are a believer, the work of transformation begins. I've said this many times before, long ago, that for this work of transformation to begin, you yourself must be yielded. This has been the challenge. Whether we are yielding ourselves, our lives, to God. Whether we are open to God to use us as He pleases, not according to our own choosing. Do you understand that? Now, when a man has entered that level where the transformation has taken place in his life, where it is what God says that matters, that man will know that this is the will of God. Don't ask me about the mechanism, or the mechanism for it, but I know that if you do your own bit, God's will will be done. You will know that you know that you know that you know that this is the will of God. But we have a situation where many of us are dancing around and we are doing permutations and combinations and trying all sorts of things to arrive at God's will. You never arrive at God's will. God's will is always revealed. Do you understand that? The will of God is a revelation of God's desire or decision to a man. Is that understood? Now, who is it that can receive that will of God? That's what Romans 12:2 is saying to us. That number one, you must be holy. Number two, you must be transformed. You cannot be living in the flesh and say you know the will of God. You don't know. You cannot. Because it's revealed by God. I believe we've looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 2 before. From verse 9, where it says that we have received not the spirit of this world, but the spirit of God, that we might freely know those things that have been given to us. If indeed you are for them walking according to the spirit, it will be there. In Ephesians chapter, Galatians chapter 5, I think verse 25 or so. If you are open there, let's read it.
If we live in the spirit, let us also walk in the spirit.
If we lay claim that we are living in the spirit, that is, we are spiritual, then let us see the walk according to the spirit, not according to the flesh. Remember, above that, he has discussed the works of the flesh and the fruit of the spirit. So if you say that you are spiritual, that you are living in the spirit, then let us see you walk in the spirit. walk according to how the Spirit is leading you. Is that understood? Which is what is also being said in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. So when a man is transformed, that is, he's walking by the Spirit, he will know the will of God. He will know that will that is good, acceptable, and perfect. He's not going to try to change it, because that's the will of God for him. And he will accept it. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.